To continue here in 1 John chapter 5, so if you have your Bibles, will you turn over there with me if you will, and we'll just start going down here verse by verse and not recapitulate over a lot of things that we have done before. So we're over here to 1 John here in chapter 5, and he tells us about here in verse 4, if you'll notice here, he says, "But whosoever is born of God," when you're born of God, is not speaking about your first birth, because we're all created of the Lord. But born of God means you've been born again. John chapter 3 and verse 3 and also in verse 7 says, "Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." How are you born again? Literally in the Greek it reads, "Except a man be born from above." Now when he says "from above," means there's nothing on this earth that you can do to merit eternal life. You can go to church all your life and go to hell when you die. You can be baptized so many times, the frogs knew your social security number. You'll go right to hell. Baptism does not save you. You can be a good person. You can be a good mother. You can be a good father. You can be a wonderful person and still die in your sins, because the best we can do falls short of the glory of God. You see, in Romans 3:23, the Word of God says, "We've all sinned and come short of the glory of God." But in Romans chapter 6, verse 23, it says, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life." Heaven is never a reward. Heaven is always a free gift. That's why Jesus Christ came to this earth. He died on the cross to pay your penalty and mine for to give us eternal life. Therefore, God loved the world, gave His only begotten Son, that He did that. That whosoever believeth in Him would never perish but have eternal life. I thank God that I know that I'm going to heaven, because it doesn't depend upon me being a pastor. Pastors go to heaven the same as anybody else does. We go to heaven the same as a drunk, an alcoholic, a drug addicted person, a prostitute, or anybody else. Every one of us, no matter what our social standing is, no matter how good we are, we fall short of the glory of God. That is God's perfection. So therefore, we trust Jesus Christ, who paid for our sins, and therefore we have the assurance that we have eternal life. That's what it means to be born of God. We overcome the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. What world does that mean? No, when we're born again, we overcome hell, because Christ took the hell on the cross for us. But overcome the world means, very simply, there isn't anything in this world that we cannot overcome by our faith in Jesus Christ. We don't have to succumb to the world. We can overcome the world when, if we listen to what God says, "Come out from among and be separate, saith the Lord, touch not the unclean thing." Most of the problems that Christians get into, or anybody else, is following their peers or running with the wrong crowd. That's usually where it all begins. Amos chapter 3 verse 3 says, can two walk together except they agree? And that's why in 2 Corinthians chapter 6 he says, "Come out from among and be separate, saith the Lord, and touch not the unclean thing, and I will receive you as sons and daughters." In other words, I will treat you as a father wants to treat his children. And just like us with our children, when they behave and they do things the way that we've taught them, then we're glad to give them blessings and glad to do things for them. But when they disobey and they turn from the way that their parents have taught them, then we find out they have to be spanked once in a while. They have to be corrected once in a while. And God will do that to His children. He surely will. But let's go on down now. There isn't anything in this world, if we'll learn to say yes to the right things, no to the wrong things, that the Christian cannot overcome. The important thing is, and I emphasize again, you have got to watch who you run with. That is the important thing. You will become who you associate with. Mark it down, never fails. Now, let's go on down. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? So the ones that have the power and the victory to overcome and lead the Christian life, only a Christian can lead a Christian life. That's the only person who can do it. Why? Because we have the Holy Spirit of God within us. Greater is He that's in you than he that's in the world. So, I have a stronger force within me saying, no, don't do that. Yes, go ahead and do that. And so forth. You may have the leading of the Holy Spirit to witness to somebody or to pass out of track. And the old nature will say, well, now, you don't push your religion off on them. But the Word of God says, go into all the world and preach the gospel. Paul said in Romans 1:16, I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. It is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also the Greek. No regard for nationality, color, race, or anything like that. We have an opportunity, the Holy Spirit may say, go witness to that person. But the old nature will say, don't embarrass yourself. But I got to remember this. If I practiced the same thing that the person who led me to Christ, I'll witness to that person. But if that person practiced what my old nature doesn't want me to do, doesn't want me to witness to somebody because they may make fun of me or something like that, well, then I would never have been saved. Because the preacher wasn't ashamed to come down to my house and tell me that there's only one way to heaven, and that is Jesus Christ. John 14:6, I am the way, Christ said. I'm the truth, and no man comes to the Father except through the Son. So let's go on down. In verse 6 and 7, it shows, first of all, in verse 6, that this is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit that bears witness, because the Spirit is truth, that is the Holy Spirit. We find out today there are many counterfeit spirits. There are spirits of Antichrist. How do you know which is true and which is not? Well, let me just give you one thing. We find out that the Word of God, when God completed it in about 96 with the writing of the book of Revelation, the Word of God is complete. So when somebody comes up to me and says, boy, I had a dream last night, I'll tell you what, and the Holy Spirit spoke to me in a dream. Well, I can say to them, no, you had too many onions on your pizzas. No, you didn't have a dream of there. And I'll refer you back to Eliphaz, who had a dream in Job chapter 4, but it turned out to be a satanic dream. No, your dream was not of the Holy Spirit. It was not of God the Father, and it was not of God the Son, and it was not of the Holy Spirit. It was a counterfeit spirit, because the Word of God says in Proverbs chapter 30 and verse 6, add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove thee, and thou be found a liar. So we are to be discerning. We find out in 1 John, if we go back a chapter, chapter 4, verse 1 and 2, it says, try the Spirit. You are to judge what people say when it comes to religion or anything else. I mean, you judge a politician, do you not? Absolutely. You judge other things that people say, do you not? Absolutely. You're to judge what people say when they come on. Now, am I going to judge what Jehovah's Witnesses say? Absolutely. You tell me there is no Trinity? You tell me that Jesus Christ was not God in human flesh? I'm going to judge what you say by the Bible, because the Bible says that Jesus Christ was God. I and my Father are one. Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, in the beginning God, that's Elohim. El is God, the I am in the Hebrew is the plural. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Well, in John, the Gospel of John that wrote the first John here, he said in chapter 1, in verse 1 and 2, he said, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Jehovah's Witnesses put, was a God. The only problem with that is there is no letter A in the Greek or the Hebrew for the letter A. There is no article at all. So it had to be inserted and made up. The Greek doesn't have a letter for A. The Hebrew doesn't have a letter for A. So saying we translated it out of the manuscripts, therefore, and put A in, it would have been impossible, because the Hebrew and the Greek don't have A. Now, I'm going to have to judge whether those Jehovah's Witnesses are telling me the truth. I'm going to have to judge whether the evolutionist is telling me the truth or not, and so forth. So you're going to have to make judgments all your life. And this idea, well, I don't want to judge. Well, you're a fool if you don't want to judge, because God tells you to judge everything. And you need to do that. You've got to judge whether the Bible is right or wrong when God said, I love the world and gave my only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have eternal life. You've got to make a decision. Every person has to make a decision. If you believe it and you're trusting Jesus Christ, you're saved on your way to heaven. If you don't believe it, God said, whosoever believeth not is condemned already. Then you're under the condemnation of Almighty God and you're headed to hell. You've got to make a decision. You make decisions all your life about where you buy insurance, what kind of car that you want, and so forth. You make decisions who you're going to marry. You make decisions all the time. Comes to the Bible, oh, we shouldn't judge. You better judge, or you're going to be grossly deceived. What does it say? The Spirit is truth. So the Holy Spirit wrote the Bible, because all Scripture is given by the inspiration of God. So I'm going to judge anybody that tells me anything that contradicts the Bible. So the more I know of the Bible, the less apt I am ever to be deceived, because I'm going to weigh what you tell me or you tell me or anybody else tells me against the Word of God. And if it agrees, then you're on the Lord's side. Then if you've trusted Christ, you're a brother and sister in Christ. Forget denominations, there are none in the Bible. Now, let's go on down. This is he that came by water and blood. Now, many of your men, even Dr. Cameron and Arnsides and some of the others, there say the water and blood is referring to the cross, because when the Spirit was put into the side of the Lord Jesus, then there came out water and blood. There are others that hold to the fact that the water is referring to the Word of God. And according to John there, except a man be born of the water and of the Spirit. I truthfully believe is referring to, could be referring to, the Word of God. Because the Word of God and water is used as cleansing all the way through the Bible. You are clean through the Word, John 15:3. Ephesians 5:26, God cleansed his church by the washing of the water by the Word. And it's not referring to baptism, it's referring to the Word of God. And out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water, and so forth. Referring the water, referring here to the Word of God and the Holy Spirit and so forth. But let's go on down. He says, the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. Now, when you're born again, you have the Holy Spirit of God. Because Romans tells us that if you have not the Spirit of God, you are none of his. So you have the power and the wisdom to discern what is right and wrong from the Word of God, because the same Holy Spirit that wrote the Bible is the same Holy Spirit that indwells you. And it is truth. The Holy Spirit will never lie to you. People will sometimes say, well, the Holy Spirit said this. Or I had a dream and the Holy Spirit, God spoke to me. We had a man who came to this church for quite some time. And He was saying, you know, I seen Jesus sit right beside me speaking, and it was Jesus. I remember asking him, I said, how do you know it was Jesus? What did he look like? Well, he looked like the picture that Warner Selman had painted, that we see Jesus, the most common picture that we have, with Jesus with the long hair draping down over his shoulders. And he described Jesus perfectly. I said, what you seen was a counterfeit. Now, if you go down, I remember when I was going through Bible college and was down in Miami, Florida, the Hispanic people down there have a picture of Jesus, and he's not quite my have quite my haircut. I'm trying to see somebody around here. Everybody in here is bald, seems like, but not quite. But he had a short haircut. He's more like Tim back there. He had a little shorter haircut, and he looked something like a haircut like Tim had. Now, that's how the Hispanic people pictured him and how they picture him. We have no idea what the Lord Jesus Christ looked like. We do know that he didn't have long hair. And probably the picture of Warner Selman is probably going to be a picture of what the Antichrist will impersonate, because even in Christendom, we all picture this is what Jesus looked like. Couldn't be anything further from the truth. The Antichrist, when he comes on the scene, will probably personify that picture and appear. And because we do know that after the rapture takes place, this Antichrist goes into the temple in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, and it says, he opposeth and exalteth himself above all that is called God, so that he as God setteth in the temple, declaring himself to be God, and he will deceive the whole world. If the whole world's already looking at Jesus by the picture of Warner Selman, all he has to do is have a hairstyle like that draping clear down over his shoulders. We know that's not what Jesus looked like, for one thing. 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 14 says, doth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it's a shame unto him? Oh boy, am I a glory to God. Amen. We don't have her hanging down there, you know. But let's go on down. Here we go. In verse 7, now we find out something interesting here, because there's three that bear record. And do you know something? Your life is watched every second of what you do, where you go, what you say, and what you think. Every second of your life. Now notice here, if you will, in verse 7. Now we know that this is given here and tells us of the Trinity. God is the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, and these three are one. Now, but we also, it says something else about this. For there are three that bear record in heaven. Do you know that when you were born, your name had already been written in the Lamb's Book of Life? Do you know that every person ever born on this earth has their name in the Lamb's Book of Life, you have a head start on going to heaven. You're the only one that can remove your name out of the Lamb's Book of Life. Isn't that amazing? When does a lost person remove their name from the Lamb's Book of Life? When they die without Jesus Christ, because they have no second chance after they die. They have none. We find out that if they have rejected Christ, then their name is blotted out. But isn't that interesting? For there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, that is God the Father, and the Word. Now the Word is the Lord Jesus Christ. In John chapter 1, verse 1, we just quoted it. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. And all things were made by Him. Without Him was not anything made that was made. Jesus Christ is God, but there are three: the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And notice what it says, and these three are one. Isn't it amazing? You go back, and this is sort of interesting, just hold your place, go back with me to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 4, because you say, we have the Trinity back here in the Old Testament. Oh, we've got it all through there. It's everywhere. But let's go back here to Deuteronomy, and we'll just give you one here because it's so simple, and you'll learn a little bit about the Hebrew back here. Very, very simple. We're not going to give you anything complicated or that, but something you can write here, and you can have it, all right? Deuteronomy chapter 6 here in verse 4. You'll find out in the King James translation, which is the best translation you can find anywhere, any place. It is the closest to the taking word for word from the Greek and the Hebrew here, putting it into English. But notice what it says here. Now, we'll give you a little Hebrew lesson here, very simply. Don't get excited, because you're not going to have to learn the Hebrew language. I don't even know it myself. So I can't memorize it, even though I had it. I can't memorize it anymore. Hear, O Israel, the Lord. See that, all capital letters? That, in the King James, when they translate it, it means that it is singular, and it is Jehovah, J-E-H-O-V-A-H, singular. Just mark that in your Bible. Now, you'll notice all capital letters. Whenever you find in the King James all capital letters for Lord or God, it indicates, if you look this up in your Hebrew, it's always Jehovah, singular, always. That's why they made this distinction. Now, look here, our God, see the word God there? That's the same word, and you'll notice in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, in the beginning, God, it's a capital G, but it has a small O-D. Now, when King James translated that, they did that specifically to let you know this is a different Hebrew word, which is Elohim. El is God in the Hebrew, the I-M is the plural. So, this is sort of interesting, and we're talking of the Trinity now. So we have here, hear, O Israel, the Lord, Jehovah, singular, our God, Elohim, plural, three or more, is one, Lord, all capital, singular. The three are one. Do you get that? Can you follow that? Let's go over one more time. Hear, O Israel, the Lord, that's Jehovah, singular. Our God, Elohim, plural, is one Lord. The Lord is God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, but still is one Lord. Isn't that something? So you have it right there. And you have also in Genesis chapter 1 and verse 1, in the beginning God, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, because if that wasn't true and God would have used Jehovah instead of Elohim, then you had a contradiction in the Bible. God chose exactly the right Hebrew word, because if we would have used in the beginning Jehovah created the heavens and the earth, there would have been no room for the Holy Spirit, which in verse 2 says the Spirit of God brooded over the earth, which was involved in creation. Then you would have had a contradiction, because Jehovah singular would have excluded the Lord Jesus Christ, which in John 1, all things, John chapter 1 and verse 2, all things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made by that was made. So, using the exact right Hebrew word, Elohim, three or more, we have all involved in creation, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. But Deuteronomy says, the Lord, our God, the Lord singular, our God, Elohim, is one Lord, the three in one, just exactly what John says back here. We have in verse 7, there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. Now, there's sort of interesting else that bear record in heaven, because, first of all, you must overcome by putting your faith in Jesus Christ. Go with me to Revelation while we're right here, Revelation chapter 3 here, and notice here in verse 5. How do you overcome? We find out here, by believing on the Lord Jesus Christ. You overcome death, that is the second death. You overcome hell, you overcome the lake of fire, and you overcome all of that to do what? Inherit eternal life and all the bliss of heaven, to live with God Almighty and to live with Him for eternity. How important that is as we get older. Amen? We had those, came down, and bless your hearts, I'd never had this before in my life, but I can remember ever since I was a teenager, came down and my wife rigged this all up, or somebody rigged it up, and for my 65th birthday. I can't believe I'm 65 years old. Now, I can believe it with my body, but my mind is still going like I'm 30 or 35. Now, you may not believe that, but I'm just saying the way I think, you know, maybe it'll cast a little doubt there, you know. But my body is not quite corresponding with my mind. My mind says, go ahead and do it, go, 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 go. My body says, hold the boat, brother. You're not 40 anymore, you're 65. Yeah, this is something to deal with. I'm having a problem with this. You know, but 65 years old, good night. I can remember in high school, I was playing basketball, boxing, stuff like that, and running track, and 65? And I was running track. Good night, I got a knee, I can't even hardly walk. And this is terrible. But it goes to show one thing, the body wears out, doesn't it? It surely does. So we thank God for the health that we got, don't we? We thank Him for every day for the health that we got, and we can do things, and dear Lord, thank You for that. But there's coming a time, if the rapture's delayed, that I'm going to die. The body is just plain going to give out, because it was only made to last 70 years, and if we live to be 80, we're doing great then. That's about the extent of the life and so forth. If I get up to 90, I'm probably not going to be as functional. There are exceptions to the rule. I'm sure I'll be one. But not really. But the body's wearing out. But I'll tell you one thing. I thank God that I have a home in heaven when I leave this earth. Amen? And I'm glad I don't have to put my trust in the philosophy of some of these idiots out here that don't know beans from apple butter, or claim that evolution is true and we come from a monkey or slip from slime or all that kind of stuff. I thank God I know where I came from. He created male and female in His image and said, reproduce after your own kind. Every human being has given birth to a baby. Amen? After their kind. I've never seen a monkey come out of a human being yet, or mother, have you? Never seen a cat or a dog or anything else. I know whom I have believed. I know what God wants me to do here. He wants me to pass on the glorious gospel that is the same gospel that I believe, that He died on that cross and paid for my sins and was buried and rose again the third day. And that gospel is what takes me to heaven. God just simply wants me to tell other people about that. And I know the third thing is most important, that if I should die before the rapture, that I'm passed from death unto life. That I'm absent from the body and present with the Lord. And the older we get, the closer we are to that kind of realization. I thank the Lord that I can put my trust in the Word of God, which liveth and abideth forever. And I don't have to trust some idiot's opinion out here because he doesn't believe the Bible. God says in Psalms 14:1, you're a fool that says there is no God. Amen. I'm glad I believe. Know where I came from, know what I'm doing here, and know where I'm going when I die. That's the peace of God that passeth all understanding. Now let's go on down. Our Revelation 3 in verse 5. Here we go. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot his name out of the book of life. See, my name had to be in the book of life in order for it to be blotted out of the book of life. But if I overcome by putting my faith in Jesus Christ and His death, burial, and resurrection, I've overcome, and my name will never be blotted out of the Lamb's book of life. Now, there are some that will. Let me take you back to Psalms chapter 69. All right? Let's go back to Psalms chapter 69. And let's give you the other side of the story, okay? Psalms chapter 69, and we're going to look at those who are going to be blotted out of the Lamb's Book of Life. In Psalms chapter 69, now uses this also as a prophecy of the Lord Jesus, but goes on down, and I'd like for you to notice here, we're just going to pick it up here in verse 21. Now we're going to read 4 or 5 verses here to come to the conclusion, verse 28. They gave me also gall for meat, and in my thirst they gave me vinegar to drink. And let their table become a snare before them, and that which should have been for their welfare, let it become a trap. let their eyes be darkened, that they see not, and make their loins continually to shake. Now, this not only is David speaking of himself, but he's speaking of also a prophecy concerning the Lord Jesus Christ. It's called a messianic prophecy. And it's exactly what they did to Christ. So it's speaking about those who reject the Lord Jesus Christ. They are a god unto themselves. They need no God. They're a fool. When they knew God, they glorified him not as God, but became vain in their own imaginations. And they changed the Creator into a creature and worshiped the creature more than the Creator. We have evolution in reverse. This is an amazing thing. When they knew God, they glorified him as not. And then we go on, clear on down from beast to four-footed things to winged birds and so forth. That's evolution in reverse. Evolution is supposed to go up the ladder and so forth. You see, but it's just reverse. They start out and deny God and end up with worshiping the creation. And evolution is nothing more than creating and making themselves a god. And you see, working themselves up into, well, there is no God, I don't need a God, I'll become a God because of my intelligence. God says, you're a fool. And they truly are. But let's go on down. In verse 4, pour out thy indignation upon them, and let thy wrathful anger take hold of them. Let their habitation be desolate, let none dwell in their tents, for they persecute him whom thou hast smitten, that's Christ, and they talk to the grief of those whom thou hast wounded. Add iniquity unto their iniquity, and let them not come into thy righteousness. These are the Christ rejectors. Now get this. Let them be blotted out of the book of the living and not written with the book of the righteous. To be blotted out, your name has to already be there. How important it is that you've trusted Jesus Christ, sir, your name, when you die and that heart stops beating and that soul and spirit of you depart from this body, that your name is not blotted out. Because if it's blotted out and you've never trusted Christ, you're going to lift up your eyes in hell, being in torment, and hear the devastating words of the Lord, depart from me, you're cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for the devil and his angels. But if you're saved, come inherit the kingdom from the foundation of the earth. Absent from the body, present with the Lord. It all hinges on your decision, what you do with Jesus Christ. If you accept him as your Savior, you're saved. And you're saved from having your name blotted out of the Lamb's Book of Life. So we come back here to 1 John chapter 5 here in verse 7. These three are one, but these three also bear record in heaven. And it is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. You say, how does the Holy Ghost bear record? Because of all the times, not only is there the Book of Life, but there's also the Book of Works. And the Book of Works has recorded in it, every time the Holy Spirit has convicted you to do something, it's going to be recorded, and the Holy Spirit's going to bear witness of that in heaven. It's going to be written in the books there and so forth. Did I obey what God wanted me to do, or did I disobey what God wanted me to do? So we're saved, and our name is sealed in the Lamb's Book of Life by the blood of Christ. But then what you do after you're saved, the rest of your life, you have to give an account for. Not heaven or hell. You're already going to heaven as a free gift. You're saved by grace through faith, not of yourselves, a gift to God, not of works, at least any man should boast. But rewards now have to do with your faithfulness to the Lord after that you're saved. And they require works. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 says in verse 11, other foundation can no man lay than that which is laid, which is Christ Jesus. Now, if any man, any Christian, build upon this foundation, you can build two things, gold, silver, precious stones. You can build wood, hay, or stubble. The gold, silver, precious stones are the good works. The wood, hay, and stubble are the dross that are disobedience to the Lord, our unfaithfulness to the Lord, whatever it might be, contrary to the leading of the Holy Spirit, which will always lead us by the Word of God. And then he says in verse 14, if any man's work or any Christian's work abide, which he has built thereupon, he shall receive a reward. That's for something you do down here after you're saved. Heaven is never a reward. It's a free gift. But rewards in heaven have to do with your faithfulness here. Moreover, it's required in stewards that a man be found faithful in 1 Corinthians 4, 2. So, in verse 15, if any man's work or any Christian's work shall be burned, he shall suffer loss, but he himself shall still be saved. You never lose your salvation, but you can surely lose your rewards. When you stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and Christ passes out the rewards for all the things we could have done in our life for Jesus Christ, will there be someone over there that says, boy, thank you for telling me about Christ. I'm up here in heaven because of you. because you were not ashamed of the gospel. Thank you for telling me down there on this earth that I needed Christ and that he died for me and paid for my sins. You're going to be rewarded for that. But if you have the opportunities and you didn't tell anybody about Christ, you never passed out a tract, you never anything, I just want to be a Secret Service Christian, you're going to suffer loss of rewards. Yet so as by fire. But let's go on back. I want to get down here so we cover a little bit more, okay? Here we go in verse 8. It says, and there are three that bear witness in the earth, the Spirit and the water and the blood, and these three agree in one. Now, notice in verse 9, it's sort of interesting here, and then we're going to close with this. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is the witness of God, which he hath testified of his Son. Get this now. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. You ever had somebody lie to you? I imagine with both of our politicians, and nothing derogatory to the character, they're just full of hot air in a lot of cases. But we have Bush up there saying things, and God bless him. We have Gore saying things, God bless him. But there's a lot I don't believe about either one of them. Truthfully, we're going to come to see how it comes to pass. And especially I'm interested in if they're going to help out on Medicaid and with the prescription drugs. When you get up there a little older, you get a little worried about that because Medicaid doesn't cover a lot of that, and that can break you up. So I'm interested to see if Bush keeps his promise, if he wins, or if Gore keeps his, or whatever. But you know what? The witness of men, if we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. I really don't care about any of your opinions. I could care less. But I do care about the opinion of God, because what he says will come to pass. Follow with me now, and I can do this here in about 4 minutes. Follow with me. What's going to judge you is not the preacher. It's not the cardinals. It's not the bishops. It's not the elders. It is the Word of God as to whether you obeyed it or whether you didn't. Hold your place. Go with me to John chapter 12 and verse 48. John chapter 12 and verse 48. All right, here we go. John chapter 12 and verse 48. We're not going to preach on this. Just going to let you read them here. They'll speak for themselves. John chapter 12 and verse 48 says this. Now, he says here, he that rejecteth me and receiveth not my words hath one that judgeth him. Mark this in your Bible. The word that I have spoken, and that word is recorded in the Bible. The same shall judge him in the last day. The word, whether you believe it or not, is what's going to judge you. If somebody told you, here's what John 3:16 says, and you say, I don't believe it, that word will judge you because that word is truth. Whoever lied to you and said and told you, don't believe it, it's not true, you know, or there, and there's a lot of doubts about the Bible, go ahead, you'll doubt yourself right into hell. But the Bible will judge you. When you stand before God Almighty and he pulls out the book, he said, I wrote it in John 3:16. You believe the witness of men over the witness of God, and you're a fool. Because the witness of men, God's witness, is greater than any man. The man is the creature. God is the creator. How can the thing formed say to him that formed him, why has you made me like this or whatever? One atheist said, I thank God I'm an atheist. Well, that's just about the size of it, folks. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5. Go back here with me. I'm going to look up three more here real fast. Proverbs chapter 30. All right, here we go. Proverbs after Psalms. I don't know what Psalms is after. It's after something. I'm just kidding. Yeah. Okay, here we go. Proverbs chapter 30. Look at this in verse 5. Proverbs chapter 30, verse 5, very simply says this. In verse 5, every word of God is pure. He is a shield unto them that put their trust in him. Keep going to the right and come to Ecclesiastes in chapter 3 and verse 14. Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 14. Here's what it says. I know that whatsoever God doeth, it shall be forever. What God says is going to stand. It shall be forever. Nothing can be put to it. You can't add to it, nor can anything be taken away from it. You're not going to take away from this word. You're not going to add to it. And God doeth it that men should fear before him, because everything that he said and prophesied has come to pass, except the yet future things to do. He named Cyrus 120 years before he was ever born. Said to be the king of Persia. Cyrus. Can you believe it? He named me 120 years before. Or maybe it was 150. I think it was 150. I have to go back and look it up. But it's somewhere between 120 and 150. Now, if you can tell me somebody's going to be born and what he's going to be named before they're ever born, or their parents are ever born, or their parents' parents are ever born, you're doing pretty good. Go with me to Proverbs while I'll just back up here, chapter 29, chapter 29, and verse 26. In verse 26, here is the thing that throws more people because they want to be accepted in our social world. Notice what it says. Many seek the ruler's favor, but what you don't realize is every man's judgment cometh from the Lord. Many seek the ruler's favor. We all want to be friends with the mayor. We all want to be friends. Wouldn't it be wonderful that I could have my picture taken with the president? Hoopy-doo. When you're dead and gone, what makes a difference? You had it taken with Kennedy or Bush or Gore or anybody else. What makes a difference? You're just not going to add anything to your statue whatsoever. You see, now go with me to Jeremiah chapter 23, left in your Bible, and we have 1 minute left. Jeremiah chapter 23, all right? Or right in your Bible, I'm sorry. Jeremiah chapter 23. What is going to judge us? The Word of God. Jeremiah chapter 23, notice in verse 28, here we go. Just read this, and then we'll be finished here. The prophet that hath a dream, let him tell the dream. He that hath my word, let him speak my word faithfully. That's probably the biggest problem that God has today. Preachers speaking the word of God faithfully. Christians giving out the word of God faithfully. What is the chaff to the wheat, saith the Lord? Is not my word like a fire, saith the Lord, and like a hammer that breaketh the rock in pieces? You ever sit in a service, or maybe you've been in this one, and the preacher's preaching on something, you say, good night, somebody got to him Saturday and told me about myself, and he preached that sermon just against me. I'll tell you, no, he didn't really. But the Word of God is powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, and I'll tell you what, you may have an old stony heart somewhere, but the Holy Spirit wants to sort of break it in pieces so God can use you as a Christian. That's what he wants to do. Therefore, behold, I am against the prophets, saith the Lord, that steal my words, every one from his neighbor. Behold, I am against the prophets, saith the Lord, that use their tongues and say, I said it, when he didn't. Here we have the Virgin Mary appearing over to some. I wish she'd appear in Walnut Grove so I could see her sometime. She's always in some country somewhere I never get to her. The abominable snowman's always in the Himalayas where I can't reach him. They're always somewhere out of my reach. You know, I want to see him. I want to tell you something, the Virgin Mary never appeared anywhere, at any time, to any place, to anybody, under any circumstances. The Virgin Mary is in heaven. Nowhere in the Bible. Try the spirits where they be of God. Do you ever find anything in the Bible where God's going to send the Virgin Mary back? Do you ever find anything where you're to pray to the Virgin Mary? My Bible says in Timothy, there's one God and one mediator between God and man. And notice in verse 32, I'm against them that prophesy false dreams, saith the Lord, and do tell them, and cause my people to err by their lies and by their lightness. Yet I sent them not, nor commanded them by their lightness. I'm holy. I love God so much. But I had a dream last night. God spoke to me, and you're now sucked in because this man is so holy, so righteous, that God spoke to him. Well, God says, here's the word which is pure. Add thou not unto his words, lest he reprove you. No, Mr. Pious Prune, God never spoke to you. You're nothing but a false prophet. You're nothing but a liar. And my Bible says, try this verse whether they be of God. I thank God, I know whom I have believed, and I persuaded he's able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. In closing, have you trusted Jesus Christ? Is he your Savior? I hope he is, because it's your life. Nobody can do it for you. It's a decision you must make. And the second important decision you must make, am I going to throw my life away just living after I'm saved? Or am I going to do something for Jesus Christ and be faithful to him? And I want a part in leading other people to Christ so that when I get to heaven, somebody will say, thank you, Max. Thank you, so-and-so. Thank you for telling me about Christ. I'd never be here if it wasn't for you. There'll be no greater thrill you can ever have than to lead somebody to Christ. Let's just bow in a word of prayer. Father, we're grateful to you and we thank you so much. Thank you that, and I pray, dear Father, that everyone here has put their faith in Jesus Christ. If not, they can do it right now. It's so simple. I know that I'm a sinner. We've all sinned. And dear Father, I don't want to go to hell. And I thank you that you went to the hell of the cross just for me. And I'm trusting you as my personal Savior. And I thank you for doing that for me. And I thank you that I can believe and have the peace that whosoever believeth in him would never perish but have everlasting life. And I thank you for that, dear Lord. And now that I'm a Christian, help me. Help me to be the best testimony I possibly can. And help me, dear Lord, never to be ashamed of you, for I don't ever want to be ashamed of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Help me in my Christian life. And I thank you for that in Jesus' precious name. Amen. All right, let's everybody stand and be dismissed.